monitoring your blood glucose today. And this is a very important part of knowing exactly what you're doing with your diabetes. A couple just definitions first. Somogyi effect. You may have experienced this if you're a type 1 diabetic. It's more common in type 1. It could also be called rebound hyperglycemia. What actually happens is you may go to bed at night and your blood sugar is just fine. You haven't eaten anything all night. You wake up in the morning and your blood sugar is very high, 200-300. And you think, wow, what happened? Well, what happens when you're, this could be the Somogyi effect, where your blood sugar actually dropped way down in the middle of the night. And your body, in order to keep you from dying of low blood sugar, kicked in some hormones and things that will bring blood sugar out of storage and into circulation. And so it kind of overshot. It put too much out there. And so then you've got high blood sugar. And sometimes when that happens, you think, boy, I need to take more insulin, right? That's what you would think. But actually, that's only going to make you bottom out more and make your blood sugar stay high in the morning. So what you need to do, if that's what's happening, is you need to actually cut down on your insulin, and then it won't bottom out in the middle of the night and the hormones shoot in and raise your blood sugar. Now, another thing that happens, and this is natural to all of us who are not even diabetic, it sounds similar. You go to bed at night, your blood sugar is fine, and you wake up in the morning and it's high again and you haven't eaten anything. And this is usually in type 2. It's more common in type 2. But the phenomena happens in all of us to some, because what's happening is your body, when it knows that you're going to get up, say, 5 o'clock, it's going to start getting the things ready for the day that it needs, that you're going to need. You're going to need so much blood sugar, and you're going to need this hormone and that hormone or whatever. And somehow it kind of overshot, got out more glucose than you really needed. So that happens naturally in all of us, but I think especially when you're diabetic, it kind of overshoot, okay? Now, I think you all know the value of monitoring your blood sugar. I hope you do anyway. This is what tells you what your diet is doing, what your exercise is doing. You know, before we had these little monitors that we could just do at home, people had to wait till they went to see their doctor, or they did a little urine test that just told if there was sugar in their urine. But usually that's at least 2 hours after your blood sugar's been up. Then it starts spilling over into your urine. So these blood glucose monitoring machines are a real blessing, and you need to take advantage of them. Use them and learn what your blood sugar is doing. You can see all the different reasons they help. They give you immediate feedback for achieving and maintaining specific glycemic goals. That means the blood sugar, what your blood sugar is doing. Obviously, it helps prevent and helps you detect when it's happening and avoid hypoglycemia. You don't want to have hypoglycemia. So this can help you prevent that by seeing what your blood sugar is doing. You know, taking your blood sugar at least every morning when you're fasting, take it about the same time every morning, and then until you know or get off of medication or whatever, you should take it at least 2 hours after you begin eating each meal. So if you start eating your breakfast at 7, you take your blood sugar at 9 o'clock, okay? And that tells you the after blood sugar rise. And who can tell me what is normal for a blood sugar 2 hours after you eat? 140. 140 is normal for even non-diabetic after you eat. exercise and types and amounts of food. It's very good to use this. You know, we can give you some guidelines that will help you to know which foods generally are going to make your blood sugars go up a little more than others. Even among good foods, you know, for some people, corn and carrots make their blood sugar go up. But for others, they don't. And certain fruits can make your blood sugar go up more. Even though they're good and healthy for you, certain ones can make your blood sugar go up. So try those sometime and see, what did it do to my blood sugar? And you can say, you know, I don't have to eliminate that from my diet. And my body handles that fine. So it's very good to help you to gauge how your body can handle certain of the foods. Also, exercise. And a little thing you'll need to know is, if you take your blood sugar before you exercise and you say, well, it's 105, you go out and exercise for 10, 15, 20 minutes, you come back, and if you take that blood sugar right away, is it going to be up or down? Well, overall, exercise is dramatic at taking your blood sugar down, but right after you've exercised, it's going to be up. Because what happens is your body realizes that you're using blood sugar, so they've got to get it out and get it ready for you to use. So it brings blood sugar out of storage into the bloodstream. And so then if you wait 10 to 15 minutes after you've stopped exercising, then your body realizes, oh, okay, they're not using it as much anymore. I guess we can put it away. So it puts the glucose back in storage. So wait 10 to 15 minutes after you've exercised, and then you can take it. Because exercise is a great way to bring your blood sugar down. They mentioned, you know, having a walk after every meal, 15 minutes. That's not like a shot of insulin. It's very good. Now, don't take that instead of your insulin, but that will greatly help that. Okay, the machines can also help you to identify reasons for glucose changes. You can say, you know, I bet it was, you know, I'm not feeling well, so my blood sugar's up a little bit, or, you know, whatever. It can help you identify. You should know what your blood sugar is and what it runs. You know, when is my problem area? My problem area is when I get up in the morning, or my problem area is 2 hours after a meal. Those are the kind of things you need to know about your response to what you're doing. Now, when you're looking at what meter to use, you probably, hopefully you all have a meter. There are different features you need to consider. Your dexterity, your ability to feel, are your hands crippled? You may want to have one that, like this one, that has only large movements for a person to make. You just pull back on this. There's a disc inside. I think it's empty right now because I've done this so many times. And you push it back in, and the strip comes out here automatically. So you don't have to, if you don't have real fine movements, you don't have to worry about putting the strip in and seeing. Maybe you can't see very well to see where the little hole is. So there are ones that have the strips inside already, and then when you're finished, you just push that little button and the strip falls out. So there's no fine movements, you don't have to see very well or anything. And also, the Lancet, the pricker, it has large movements as well. It's not round, small, it's geared for easy holding if you don't have real dexterous ability. Also, these have a larger screen. There are ones that are very small, and some people, that's fine. They want a small one they can just stick in their shirt pocket and go. And there are ones that are smaller than this. Okay, I'll tell you, though, I'm not trying to sell anything. This is a Breeze 2 by Bayer. And this is a Freestyle Flash. There are several Freestyles. There's Freestyle Light, and Freestyle was the first one to come out with 5-second monitoring when all the rest were still at 30 seconds. This one went to 5 seconds. That was a big deal. And all the rest of them needed a larger amount of blood, and And this one was, this takes just a tiny, tiny bit of blood. And now all of them have gone to that. That's the thing. Once a neat feature comes out in one of them, all of them kind of have to move that way. And one thing you need to remember, if anything goes wrong with your monitor, call the 800 number. They will step you through what to do to troubleshoot. And most of the time, if there's any problem, they will send you free a new meter. The reason for that is they don't make money on the strips. They make, on the machine, they make it on the strips. And they're all about the same, about $1 a piece of the main brands. There are ones that are off brands that are probably just as good, and you can get the strips a lot cheaper. But all of these main brands are about the same as far as the strip cost. Also, this was the first one with alternative sites that you can test on your arm or your hand or wherever you want to test with these to give your fingertips a break. Okay. There are also ones that this one does not have, you don't put in a lancet. There's a little drum inside here that, so you never have to see the needle if you have a real needle phobia. So that's a nice lancet thing. And then there's ones, a lot of them are coming out now. You can get software where you can plug them into the computer and chart what your blood sugar's been doing and your average. And you can put what you've been eating, how you've been exercising, all kinds of things. You can punch that into here. A lot of them are coming out with something similar to that. There's one other one I wanted to point out. This one is good if you only have one hand that you can use. You can use this one with one hand. You turn it on right here, and if I haven't used up all the strips, a strip will come out automatically. I can cock, this is my lancet. I can cock this right here, and I can, prick my finger, and then read it, and then when I'm finished, I just push the same button, and the strip falls out. So you can do it all with one hand. You don't have to be one-handed to use it. It's still good even if you don't. And that's the thing. Most of the machines are fine. Whatever machine you have. If you have older ones, it's often good to get a new one every few years. They have new features, and they're updated and stuff. Okay, let's continue going through this. These are just things you want to consider when you consider a different meter. The insurance guidelines. Some insurance companies have contracts or whatever with different meter companies. And so your insurance company may say, well, we'll cover anything in this brand, but not this brand. So that's something to consider, because oftentimes they will purchase, you'll get a free one. And oftentimes you can get free meters through your pharmacist or anybody else. What? Yeah. Not the strips, right? But insurance companies will cover more on certain brands of those two. So you need to know what your insurance does. Now, whole blood versus plasma calibration. That doesn't change anything that you do in the machine, but some of the machines calculate the glucose based on whole blood or plasma. And you should be able to find that out in the little booklet that comes with your meter. But you don't do anything any different. And I think that most of them are now with plasma, because that's what the lab does. So most of them now are. Okay. Whole blood versus plasma blood. If you have one that has a whole blood, which would probably just be an older one, you just use the formula that's listed there. Multiply what you get by 1.12, and that will give you the plasma reading, which would correspond with what the lab value is. This is a list of ones that use plasma, are plasma calculated. And basically, these are the ones that are being used. These, most of these are, at least the main brand ones, are not used anymore. So I think they're all going to plasma. These are just some Medicare test strip reimbursement guidelines. If you want Medicare to reimburse you, this is what you have to have. You have to be treated by a physician. You can't say, well, I'm treating with lifestyle, and so I don't go to a physician. You have to have a physician that is following you for your diabetes. It has to be the physician ordering the supplies that treats you. It can't be your eye doctor if he's not your primary diabetes doctor. You have to be trained to use the equipment, be capable of monitoring the results for glucose control. In other words, if you're senile or blind or something, you have to have some way of someone else helping you or some way of using the results. It has to be designed for home use, not a used one from the hospital or whatever. If you require more than 100 strips a month, you have to have a prescription from the physician. When you're doing finger sticks, we don't really recommend that you do the alcohol swab anymore. It tends to dry out your skin more, make it, and we're trying to protect your fingers so that you can test them often. Hang your arm down briefly to let the blood flow there, and then grasp your finger and pinch it for about 3 seconds just before you poke it. Now, oftentimes people do that afterwards, but it's actually better for the results if you do that before. If you do have to use alcohol, say you're in a dirty place and you know your hands are dirty, go ahead and use alcohol, but make sure that it's dry before you do that. And if you stick your finger on the sides of the finger, obviously you've probably all discovered that you don't notice it as much when you're typing or whatever else you're doing. Things that affect your glucose level, obviously inadequate blood sample. You need to know what your meter does. Some meters beep when there's enough blood. Some of them won't do it if you don't have enough. Some of them will do it, but they'll show a wrong reading. So, you know, there are different things. You need to know what your meter does. And if you have a question about your reading, obviously repeat the results. Obviously check if your strips are expired. If your meter has been too hot or too cold, it may not give an accurate reading, so let it come to within room temperature before you do it. And of course, you all know that when you have a new bottle, well, of course, the newest thing that they're going to is you don't have to code, but if your meter needs to be recoded every time you open a new vial of strips, be sure to do that, because that's the most common reason for inaccurate blood sugars, is people do not recode their meter every time they open a vial. Okay. If you don't get the test for the control solution, if it's not calibrated right, you just call the company. They'll tell you what to do and send you a new one. Okay, if you want to compare your finger stick with a lab, obviously this is pretty common sense. Do it at the same time. Adjust for the whole blood levels if yours uses a whole blood machine. Only fasting blood sugars should you compare with the lab. And don't, you know, when the person takes the needle out of your arm, they're drawing the blood for the lab. Don't use that blood for your machine. Yours is based on capillary blood. Theirs is, they're using venous blood. Even if you're doing it here on your arm for an alternate site, you are still using capillary blood. So yours is based for capillary blood. So don't just use what they have used. Alternate site testing. If you want to use alternate sites, you only use alternate sites before a meal or an insulin dose or before exercise or 2 hours after each of those. So you have have to do it only at those times. And because fingertip samples reflect rapid change sooner. So if you're trying to see what it is, the fingertip samples will reflect that much sooner. Okay, we're quickly going to go over a few points for foot care. 1 in 6 people with diabetes will develop a foot ulcer in their lifetime. You heard a lot about this from Dr. Chin this morning. People with diabetes are 25 times more likely to lose a leg from an ulcer. So your foot care is very, very important. General foot care, wash your feet daily with a mild soap. Dry them well, especially between your toes. That's very important. Between your toes is important. We don't think about it very often. But that's how fungus starts, is moisture on your feet. So you need to keep them dry. When you apply lotion, which it is good to apply lotion every day to your feet, do it to the top and the bottom, especially if there's calluses, but not between your toes. Again, it keeps moist there, and that's a good way to start fungus. If you have calluses, of course, use the lotion, but also file them. Don't try to surgery them off with a razor or a blade or anything. You need to file them off. And you need to find out why you have calluses. Calluses are not normal. I mean, that's considered a foot problem. So you need to find out what's causing the callus. If your shoes aren't fitting right, if your socks are rubbing, whatever it is, you don't want to get a callus because there can be infections start underneath that. So there's a reason why you have a callus. So find out what that is and alleviate that cause. Don't walk barefooted at home or outside. You don't want to stub your toe, step on something, especially if you have neuropathy and can't feel very well. Check inside your shoes for loose objects and rough spots. That's very important. Check your shoes out frequently. Every time you put them on, dump them out. Make sure there's nothing inside, because if you can't feel, there can be a tack. Many people have worn a tack in their foot for a long time and didn't know it was there. So do not always check your shoes. Get medical help to correct deformities. It can be something very simple. I had a man that said, you know, I have spent tons of money on my shoes. I have closets full of shoes. He spared nothing. And he says, my feet hurt all the time. There's nothing that will help. And I looked, and they looked like perfectly healthy feet. Well, I gave him these little gel-type things that you can put between your toes, or toe separators, because I saw that one toe was going underneath the other toe. And do you know, he had no more foot problems. And I thought, how simple. It was free. You may have to pay a little bit, but it was free for him. So be sure to correct whatever is happening. It may be something very simple, but get some help with it. Daily foot inspection. Dr. Chin talked about this, using good light. Observe the top and the bottom and between the toes. Okay? Between the toes is important. And the bottom. If you can't see, get a mirror, hold it like this, or have someone else help you, but you need to check your feet. The changes you're looking for, hopefully you won't see. If you have cuts or cracks, scratches, blisters, calluses, corns, ingrown toenails, signs of infection and fungus. Remember, the reason that people have such problem with their feet is the circulation is not as good. And so any of these things, they aren't going to heal as fast. They don't have as good a nutrition coming to them. Feel your feet. See if they're warmer in one spot than another. That's a sign of inflammation or infection. And the sooner you catch any of these, the easier it's going to be to deal with them and prevent them from becoming serious. Now, when you cut your toenails, if you can't see to do it or can't reach them, get someone to do it that can see and can reach them. They're easiest to cut after bathing. It's amazing how much difference that makes, because they're nice and soft. after being in the water. Use blunt scissors if they're real sharp. It's easy to poke yourself. I mean, you know, you think, I'm not a kid. I don't need blunt scissors. But it's amazing how easy it is to poke yourself, even when you can see well and reach it well. So cutting them straight across is what they usually say, with filing the corners to round. And I always say, make them the shape of your toe. Because I've seen some toes that if they cut them straight across, they'd have a real mess. So kind of the shape of your toe. You don't want them, generally you want them flat across the top, but if your toe is pointed, you have to make them a little more rounded than flat. So you go semi by the short size of your foot, your toe. Don't cut too short, obviously, and seek medical help for ingrown toenails because you're not a surgeon. You don't want to do the surgery, so you want to. There are some things that could be helpful until you can get to medical help. Putting a charcoal poultice on it, doing some hot and cold on it can help with an infection. But don't hesitate to get help. Don't do the surgery yourself. Selecting socks. Clean socks daily or more often if you have feet that perspire very easily. Cotton or wool blend with some synthetic fibers. The synthetic fibers tend to help wick the moisture away from your body, and so you want to have some synthetic fibers there. Not too tight, especially at the top. You don't want to cut the circulation down any more than it already is. But you don't want it too loose either, because loose, damp socks can help with fungus, but also they can make blisters. The friction there is much more if you have loose, baggy socks. Minimal seams across the toes. This can be a big thing, especially if your shoes are a little tight. They have diabetic socks now, and they're very nice, but whatever you get, make sure they have minimal seams. Sometimes they call them seamless, but they aren't seamless. But minimal seams across the toes, across the end there. Selecting shoes. A thick, flexible rubber sole so that it bends when you walk is the best. Closed toe and heels so that you don't stub your toes, you don't drop something on it. It's got a little bit of protection there if you do drop something. The toe box, which is the end of the bottom, the end of the shoe where your toe is, should be wide enough and deep enough to accommodate your toes. If you have hammer toes, they have shoes now that have a deeper toe box to allow for that. If you have bunions, whatever you have, buy shoes that accommodate your feet and try to deal with those deformities as well. Of course, avoid pointed shoes. Do we even need to say that? When you're shopping for shoes, shop late in the day when your feet are the largest. If they're going to be swollen, that's when you need to buy shoes so that you don't buy them when they're not swollen and then they swell and it's like, now what do I do? Okay, break new shoes in gradually. Don't buy them the day before a long hike and then try to wear them the next day. But they do need breaking in, but don't expect, you know, don't buy uncomfortable shoes and say, well, I'm going to break them in. They'll get okay. They should be comfortable when you start walking in them, even though you may still need to break them in. So that's an overview of how to take care of your feet. Remember, they are very, very important. They're not replaceable, so take good care of them.